this thing so long, I've been bearing this weight. It's been good weight. It's been a good weight to wait on the Lord to get the blessings, the anointing, the of everything that he's had in this bag.
It was worth the wait.
Yeah, it was glory. It's glory.
It was worth the wait.
Yeah.
You gotta know from verse 6 to 41 is a wait.
Yeah.
It's a long way. They're not just tripping through the text. They traveling through the book. There's so many lines between that, that like people have no idea what you've come through. They have no idea the road that like God placed me on, that I've been traveling, I've tripped up on my way trying to score, but couldn't make it because I missed it because my feet failed me. They have no idea the lines that you had to follow, that you couldn't go any other way because your daddy kept you on the straight and the narrow, but you still messed up, came up short. You would take the jump, but like Shaq, it just wouldn't. It will hit the back and come back. It's something when people look at you and discount you. You don't even say nothing about it. You know why you couldn't say nothing about it? Because when you got there, you didn't deal with Elijah. You dealt with you being able to give yourself the own answer. That I've been carrying glory. That's why I can come and testify of the story. That's why there's no shame when you share what you've been through and who you've been with and what should have but couldn't have taken you because you've been carrying glory. This ain't nothing to be ashamed of. I'm proud of the glory I wear on my skin. I'm proud of the folk who stayed with me and then cannot even see the change in me because one day they'll signify there was a difference in me. That wasn't me being bougie. It was me carrying glory. It was glory that allowed me to come from 6 to 16. Now, you know what I'm talking about. That the next year I'll be 30. But in a few years, sir, you'll be 42. Somewhere between 6 to 40. You got to pick up in the text and say, all of this means nothing but the beginning and the end. That I showed up, was able to carry it, and then I got through it. Now I can drop it off and say it was glory that got me out of it.
Guess what?
Glory was here.
6 minus 41. What is this? 35.
35.
I'm 35.
35. He told Abraham it was well in his 70s that his wife, who was older than him, disgusting woman, she thought everything was funny that wasn't, laughed inappropriately.
Right.
Laughed in the face of God.
Laughed and lied.
Lied about it. God had to set her straight. The same way that you have to do your biggest enemy, you. That you did laugh at how you didn't believe that you would make it here. How you thought that life would have betrayed you and you killed you long time ago. And I think when God steps into the kitchen with her, because she's in the tent making some foolishness bread, some soggy dish, he said, you did laugh. But it says it with a stern face and it shakes heaven so much that her womb opens. The day you laughed at you, when the gun didn't go off and blow your head off. The day you laughed at you sitting in the bathroom, putting the needle in you, praying to God that he takes you but it couldn't kill you. The day you laughed was the day the womb opened. I know you didn't feel it because it was something happening on the inside. God said, I'm preparing the womb for you to birth you. No, you can't travel back into that destitute, dead place. You can't go back there. You can't. You call your mama. You want to. You know, you're trying to be reborn, son. You have. You committed. You cannot go back there. So I'm birthing the womb of you through you. Because only you can bear you. That's what Elijah said. I had to bear it. Not the money. Me.
Yeah.
I was birthing me.
You were carrying.
You said 35 it equals. And how many weeks are you pregnant with a baby before you give birth to it?
Oh, it's 35 to 38 weeks.
Yeah. You're right on the precipice.
Yeah.
You did what she said. You're right, and this is the 12th month.
Yeah.
Now, I know Elizabeth Mary's cousin was in her ninth month, but Mary was in her sixth. That's three. Six, but he had three more months left. She had to realize what she was carrying. But we forget it because there's no glory in us because we don't speak it out of us. He said it's not for you to say it. It's not even for you to wear it. It's for you to bear it. Bear it and birth it. So get ready, not today, but before the end of the, because that's what the 12 is for, before the end of this year.
Absolutely.
That you're birthing not the transformed you. You've already been renewed and restored. You've already been declared and confirmed. That you're birthing the you that don't care about poor because you can help them. And don't care about the house because you can buy it for them. That don't care about the bag because you can deliver it to everybody who didn't even have it. I've been preparing you to know what it's like to be poor so you can teach other people how not to ever come here. That's why you can care about it, because you can change it. You can fix it. It's not a problem unless it's not a problem.
Yeah. Literally.
That's the only way it's not going to be a problem, when it's not a problem. So I need you to be concerned about it. Just don't care not to change it.
Right.
But transform it. Make it not a problem that somebody has to care about anymore.
When somebody comes to me and they say they have self-esteem issues or that I don't like myself, and I say none of that's important.
Yeah.
What is important is how we're going to change our talk.
That's right.
How we're going to walk a different walk.
I don't tolerate it. I don't compensate for it. I don't pacify it. I fix it. That's how we know that, like, being not okay is not the answer.
Right.
You don't become complacent. You get up and you fix it. Or you lay down and deal with it.
Right.
Or you go home and put it out. Or you get in the street and quit it. Whatever it is, you don't become complacent and say, it's okay, yeah, you're okay. It's not. It's toxic. Yeah. Deal with it. We grow from it. We establish ourselves to say, God, I know you built me stronger than dirt. That's why I didn't stay laying down. But he blew in me and picked me up.
Mm-hmm.
And you mean to tell me that life that he gave you rule, dominion of, can get you to the point where you lay back down with God and take the breath? You better breathe and realize that he lives in you. Not for you to be crushed by the weight of it. That's why I couldn't kill you. That's why I couldn't overdose me. That's why I couldn't shoot you. That's why I couldn't run you over and flatten you. Not the spirit that's in you. It could, no matter how high I got me, move the spirit out of me.
That's why you was able to run faster than whoever was trying to chase you. You was able to preach to yourself when you thought you were preaching to a congregation.
You said run. You said preach. Those days I gave up. But there's something on the inside.
Right.
Not me. What's that? Not me, Jacob. not even me, Esau. But there's Israel. That he proved in reason that he was real. Said you can come here and fight with God. Not him against you. But y'all against the old you,
right?
And me. To be able to say that I stood with him and made sure that I didn't give up on me, because God fought with me. Wrestled with me all night to tell me, Jeremiah, hold on. Nights we would drive over and be like, end up on the other side, drunk and all of that stuff. And it would be like, Trevor, go home. That's God fighting with you. Not against you. That's him in your ear being like, you can do this. You can make it. Stay faithful in it. Don't call it quits. Don't go sleep with them folk. Don't pick it up. Go home. That's him fighting with you to make sure you pull out. That's the labor and delivery room experience. Push your way through. But it's harder when you're pushing you. That's why God is there to cheer you. You feel the weight on your back. That's just God pushing you, trying to help you birth you.
You know, sometimes he
push me
through the birthing, through the pregnancy. Sometimes he gives us little affirmations of like who we're gonna be. So like, you know, when a woman goes for the checkup,
that's good.
They get the ultrasound. Like we see small things that he's gonna do for us, that he's bringing us to, but we don't pay attention to it, because a lot of men, when they're with their woman and they're pregnant, I can go to the checkups, I can go to the breathing, the Lamas breathing classes, I can go to all this stuff, but it's not really real to me because I'm not carrying. It's not really real to me until it's birthed. soon as I see it, that's when most men are like, they kick in. I need to do something there, something different.
If he wasn't cheering for her before,
right?
The minute it crowns,
right?
The minute he see it about to be placed on his head, the minute it crowns, the minute he's like asking it and she's forming the words, I do or yes, I will. When it crowns, that's when he gets into like not pretend mode, not play.
Right.
He's all the way in.
Right.
Where his hormones kick in, where like his strength pulls her through where she probably shouldn't have made it. Because birthing it is the closest to death a woman will ever come.
Yeah.
It's not like when he's beating the hell out of her. It's when she's birthing life, where it literally splits her in half, where she's sharing spirits then. Mm-hmm. And he has to cut the cord. That's when God decides, was it worth the journey to birth it, or could she die by the weight of it? That's when he kicks in. Baby, you can do this. You we done went through all them 9 months. I don't care if there's quadruplets in there. You can birth everyone.